Linda and Harper Audio Australia present this unabridged recording of The Great Gallipoli Escape, written by Jackie French and read by Victor Gralak. To Brian, Jack and Tom, and to Pa Jack who was there, and to all who try to stop a tragedy like Gallipoli from happening again. Prologue. The Cricket Match. Merry Creek, Wombat Flats, New South Wales. A was the anguish that spread o'er my face when I saw the remarkable look of this place. B's for Beachy Bill who fired at my ship, punctured the funnel and gave me the pip. C was the crump which went by with a screech as I jumped from a lighter and fell on the beach. From Another Attempt at an Anzac Alphabet by Ubique, 21st Indian Mountain Battery. The Anzac Book, 1915. 30th of April, 1915. Dear Johnny, you'll never guess what. Your dad was eating lunch down by the wool shed yesterday and a great kangaroo came up behind him and grabbed his sandwich. It took one bite and spat it out. Kangaroos don't like mutton and chutney. Your dad was most put out, but your gran and I laughed and laughed. We got your postcard. It is wonderful to hear from you. It was a relief seeing the ticked boxes saying you're well and thinking of us. We would love a real letter, but know it must be hard to find time and paper to write. We are so proud of you. The newspapers are all full of how courageous our Anzac troops were at the landing at Gallipoli. They are calling you all the bravest of the brave. Grandma has put your postcard up on the mantelpiece next to the Jubilee jug where everyone can see it. Here are another two pairs of socks I knitted and a belly band. It's important to keep your kidneys warm, from Auntie Iris. And a plum pudding in a billy that you might find useful, and some notepaper, envelopes and two pencils. Grandma wanted to send you some of her date scones, but we explained how far away Gallipoli is. She is making you a fruitcake instead. There is not much more news here. We are all well, though Grandma's knee is playing up again and we could use some rain. We got the best prices ever at the ram sale. The price of wool has gone through the roof with all the material needed for uniforms. Dad has bought enough wire to fence the creek flats. Everyone is trying to fence their farms now there aren't enough men to work as shepherds, but the wombats keep digging holes under the fences that the lambs can get through. There's one wombat who never gives up. Your dad fills in the hole under the fence every day, and every night the wombat digs his way through again. We've decided to call him Digger. Like you, brave lads, he doesn't let anything stop him. Daisy has had four pups. We think the father might be a dingo, but we'll keep one of the pups and try to train it up. Dad has managed to plough the top paddock, though it is hard with only one horse now. Did I tell you the others have been taken by the army? He's putting the paddock down to turnips for winter feed. We miss you terribly, but are filled with pride. Dad and Grandma and Auntie Iris send their love. The Hendersons wish to be remembered, and the Camilleris and the Summers. Katie O'Leary said to say hello, then said to send you her love. She's been helping your dad with the fencing. I think she is a very nice girl, no matter what some people say about red hair. Your loving mother, Mum. Kisses and hugs. May 24th, 1915. D was the daring I failed to display when fragments of shrapnel came whizzing my way. E was the earth that I found in my hair as I woke in the morning and crawled from my lair. F were the fleas and also the flies who feed on a fellow wherever he lies. From Another Attempt at an Anzac Alphabet. Nipper stood at the wicket, bat in hand, eyes on the ball. Sunlight poured like butter onto the stony ridge. Above him, seagulls swirled white against a blue-tinted sky. Far below, the tiny waves lapped against the golden sand of the cove. Mehmet One bowled the ball towards him. Nipper raised his bat. Thwack! The ball rose high, then down, soaring over their trench and down the cliffs, impossible to catch.
A sixer!
Yelled Spud, waving the flies away from his face. Run! Called Lanky from the opposite wicket.
Go, Nipper!
Screamed Bluey. Wallaby Joe gave Nipper a thumbs up from the sidelines. Wallaby Joe wore the Anzac summer Gallipoli uniform. Boots, trousers cut off at the knees to make shorts, his identity disc and a sunburned nose under a smear of mud. Like most of the men, he'd stitched a bit of cloth under his forage cap to protect his neck from the sun, already fierce even in spring. He'd clipped his hair as short as possible, they all had, to try to get rid of the lice. Suddenly, an unknown hand threw the ball back up the cliff. The ball thudded on the rocky ground. Mehmet too ran forward and caught it. He grinned at Nipper.
Ben de Navar, Johnny,
he yelled triumphantly. He tossed the ball to Mehmet One. Mehmet One lined up to bowl again, his face as tanned and filthy as the Aussies, his grin as wide as theirs. Nipper held the bat steady, enjoying the spring warmth on his bare chest. Lanky had been out for 18 today, but Nipper had made 98 not out in the last cricket match at Wombat Flats. He'd shown them what he could do.
Thwack!
The ball soared over the fielders and landed behind a brushwood fence next to one of the Turkish trenches.
Nipper! Spud!
Curly's voice came urgently from the trench.
Captain Withy's coming up the gully! Skedaddle!
Nipper quickly threw the bat into the nearest bit of branch. It wasn't really a bat, but a bit of the packing crate that held the bully beef cans. Now it would just look like a bit of wood again. The wickets were sticks of packing crate too. Nipper gave them a quick kick with his boot. Now there was no sign that an illegal cricket match had ever been played here on the heights of Gallipoli. But what about the ball? It was still over on the Turkish side. Nipper was proud of that ball. He'd rolled mud and straw into the right shape and let it dry in the sun, then tied a bit of torn-off shirt he'd found in the trench and tied the whole lot up with string. Nipper shoved it into the pocket of his shorts, then glanced at Mehmet Two apologetically, gesturing down as the captain strode up the gully. Mehmet Two smiled. He looked as if he was in his late 20s, the same age as Lanky and Curly. Nipper wondered what his real name was.
Oshkakal, Johnny,
Mehmet Two said, glancing down at the captain as if he understood exactly. Mehmet One had already vanished between the sandbags that led to the narrow sap and then to the enemy trenches. Nipper watched as Mehmet Two dashed towards the Turkish trench about 60 yards from the Australians, past the line of flags with their red crescents set out for today's truce. Nipper hesitated in the muck-stained ground between the trenches. Fraternising with the enemy was a court-martial offence. It might even get him shot. The men had also been ordered not to leave the trenches during today's truce, which had been arranged so the men could bury the bodies from both sides, piled four deep in places, rotting, swelling, and even exploding when anyone trod on them in the heat. Only the burial parties had leave to be outside in case emerging from the trenches gave the Allied position and numbers away to the enemy. It was a sensible order too. Many of the Turkish trenches had been invisible before the truce. It was only when lines of Turks emerged to sit on the edges that the Allied army had realised how many of the enemy they were facing. But there'd been no officers to see them today. When Nipper and Curly had come out of the trench to have a bit of batting practice, Mehmet 1 and 2 had cautiously emerged from their trench, then joined in when the Aussies grinned at them. It seemed that Turks liked cricket too, and Nipper's ball was still in their trench. Nipper didn't want to lose that ball. The trenches were too narrow for a game of cricket, but they sometimes had a bit of a kick around down on the beach when the firing was slack. Captain Withy was hidden for a moment behind a brushwood fence. Nipper raced over to the Turkish trench and gave a half salute to the startled faces looking up at him. Yet there was Mehmet Two holding the ball. Mehmet Two copied Nipper's half salute, then tossed the ball to him. Nipper caught it gratefully. It had cracked a bit with that last shot, but he was pretty sure a slather of mud would fix it. There was no sign of any German officers. They must all be down with the burial parties. Nipper doubted any of the Turks would have joined the game with officers watching. Nipper scrambled past their own line of Red Cross flags, then slipped down into his own trench just as Captain Withy wound up the narrow sap and up into the trench proper. The captain looked unbearably tired. He also reeked. The full uniform he'd put on for the truce was streaked with mud and blood and worse, though his face was unusually clean. He must have washed down at the beach. His face was shiny and whisker-free for once. He must have shaved today in the single pint of water the men received each day to look respectable for the officers living in relative luxury down at the beach. The captain noticed Nipper staring at his mucky uniform. Nipper thrust the ball into one of the cave-like bivvies dug into the trench wall behind him and saluted, then stared as some of the muck on the captain's uniform dropped off.
One of the bodies burst next to me as the ambulance bearers were lifting it, the captain said shortly, giving him a quick salute back. I washed off the worst in the sea. Nipper thought longingly of the beach below. It was only about half a mile away, but getting down there on an ordinary day might take hours, depending on the shelling, ducking behind the fences made of brush or sandbags to avoid shrapnel or the sniper's shots. The Turks were excellent marksmen. The beach and the shallow sea also had no protection at all from shots from above. Beachy Bill, the big Turkish gun, had already killed hundreds of men on the sand and in the water. But after months of living with bits of bodies rotting around you, the constant filth, the rat droppings that got into everything, a short swim was worth the risk just to get clean, to take off a uniform stiff with sweat, mud, and other people's blood. Except for today. The captain would have been able to swim in safety during the truce today, just as Nipper and the others played cricket. The casualties had been so high in the last weeks of fierce fighting that it was hard not to step on a body, three deep in places, swollen and bursting in the heat. It had become impossible to continue fighting until the bodies were dragged away. The stench had become almost unbearable, though the flies loved it, and the rats. Gallipoli was a good place to be a rat or a fly, thought Nipper, but it was almost unsurvivable for a human. A lot was almost unbearable. The hunger, the desperate thirst, seeing the mates you'd enlisted with or trained with alive one minute, staring at the sky the next, or screaming in pain. But you bore it. There was no choice. Both sides had tried scattering chloride of lime over the bodies, but it just made the smell worse. In other places, the dead were thrown into abandoned trenches or stacked two or three deep in a kind of wall, which at least gave cover from the snipers. Today, the burial parties had been carrying enemy bodies over to the Turkish trenches, while the enemy had carried the English, New Zealand, Indian, and Australian bodies over to theirs. Other burial parties took the dead down to the cemetery by the cove. The truce would also be a chance to examine each man's identity disc, to see if men who were missing were dead or had been taken prisoner. Maybe I should have volunteered for burial duty, Nipper thought. It might have given him a chance for a good swim afterwards. He glanced at the captain's face again and then was glad he'd stayed up here. The casualties up here had been cleared early by troops of men in overalls and gas masks, and most of those bodies were fresh from the battle a few days ago. And besides, today had actually been fun. Captain Withy looked at Nipper and said wryly, I didn't see you playing cricket up top, did I? Nipper grinned and said nothing. Captain Withy usually let him get away with a lot, and he'd made the most of it. The captain and the others had soon realised that Nipper wasn't 21, as he'd put down on the form so he could fight the enemy. That was how he got his nickname. He was just a Nipper. Don't worry, you're not up on a charge, said the captain wearily. Just about everyone's fraternised with the enemy in one way or another today, despite orders. He glanced at his pocket watch. Nearly 4 o'clock. Another half hour to the end of the truce. If I have the same time as the Turks and the Germans and our navy, which I probably do not, I swear the navy doesn't have an accurate timepiece among the lot of them. Captain Withy reached into his pocket and pulled out a packet of cigarettes. Take these over to the Turks if you want to say goodbye, he said quietly. Better be quick.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Nipper didn't smoke the cigarettes each man was given every week, nor did he drink the day's ration of rum. He'd promised Mum he wouldn't when he enlisted. He'd done a lot that Mum wouldn't have approved of, and even more that she'd never understand. But he usually swapped his rum or cigarette ration for more water or a slice of cake if the mail had been delivered and someone had been lucky enough to get some baking from home. His last plum pudding from Mum had been eaten weeks ago. It hadn't gone far when shared with his mates. He scrambled up the sap out of the trench, through the sandbags that led to it, past the Red Cross flags and into the middle of no man's land between the trenches. He waited by the white flags that stood at the midway point, holding the cigarettes out. A Turkish soldier emerged, not one of the men who'd come to join him and Spud when they were having a knock around, but a taller, thinner man with eyes that seemed to take him in at a glance. Nipper wondered if he was a sniper, the crack shooters on both sides who could tell a man from a shadow or where he might be hiding by a trickle of dust. He was perhaps twice Nipper's age.
Hello, Johnny, said the soldier,
The Allies were Johnnies to the Turks, just as the Turks were Mehmets or Ahmeds to them. Nipper held out the cigarettes. The soldier took them soberly.
Thank you.
You speak English?
I study a little before the war.
Mehmet 1 and 2 had seemed to only know Turkish. The man smiled suddenly.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.